Department, Federal University of Technology, Mina. So I'll start from the front. Sir?
I'm explaining that it is from the Cyber Security Science Department.
I'm Remy Afon from the National Secretariat, CSEO.
You're honored to have our president. Actually, an oversight, but I thought since we have an agenda, so we are honored today to have the entire crew from Cyber Security Expert Association of Nigeria from Abuja, in person of the National President, Mr. Remy Afon, who is coming to officially inaugurate this branch, as we are going to, as you can see on the agenda. So we'll go straight to the reading and adoption of the last meeting. This is our fifth branch meeting, and it's our practice that when we meet like this, we look at our events so that we can track our progress. So as you have, we're just going to look at section by section. So if you attend the last meeting, so I'm going to start from section one. So if you have any issue with the line number, you can just draw our attention to it. So I'm going to start with section 1.0. Item 2. Item 3.0. Item 4.0. Item 5. Item 5.1. Item 5.2.
That's 5.2, the first line.
Okay.
The off there, I think it will be.
Item 5.1.
Yes. Members were missing.
Line what?
From the first line. Okay. 33. Line 33.
Line 33, okay.
The members were mobilized from within and outside the university.
Okay. That's noted. I think the next section should be section 6.0, not 7.0. So, Secretariat, please take notes. Item 6.0. Now, 8.0 will now be 7.0. 7.0. 8.0 and 9.0 respectively. So, subject to this correction, who is moving motion for the adoption for the minutes? Those who attended. Okay, Madam Sulaiman Ahmad, and seconded by who? Okay, Dr. Idris. Ismail. So, let's quickly look at the matters arising from the last minute. I think we'll just go straight to 5.0. CEC has handed over formally to the new executives that will be. I chaired the CEC and we were able to work with School of ICT to organize cybersecurity awareness program, Stop Think Connect. For the investing, we are honored. I think the vice president was reported to, and we're also planning to have a presentation today for our strategic plan, as you can see on item number 6. So the Stop Think Connect went successfully, and we are also putting machinery in place to spread our tentacles around the entire Niger State. Monopolies like PIDA, LAPAI, we want them to know that we actually exist. And not only that, we're also looking towards going to Niger State, Ministry of Science and Technology, Parastatals, those are the people, so that the mission of CCN can actually be felt by them as our funders and as the community. In Minna, most importantly in Niger State. Then we studied the branch policy from, and we discovered that most of the executives actually there is written no definition for the portfolio. So we met and we made proposal for what is it that is expected. So we noted that. Continuous professional development is one of those things that we should, since our mandate is about championing cybersecurity awareness. So we made case for a particular portfolio called Research and Development Coordinator, who is going to be looking at how all the mission and vision that we have is going to be executed. So we asked our vice president to present that. I don't know whether he has done that. So to the national headquarters. To the national headquarters. So that instead of 6, portfolio is now going to be 7. So that when the financial secretary is thinking about how to generate funds, the president and vice president are thinking about direction, how vision of CCN can be accomplished, the research and training coordinator can be looking for resource persons. What current trends members you learn. So that's that. And of course we know we can't do that, we need fund. So we were able to generate what you have, we were able to generate 4,000 naira. Although it was so cheap, but at least we were able to generate, and we handed over a sum of 3,715 naira to the new executives on our home. So I think those are the matters. After that, then of course today we are going to be inaugurating. So we had in the second meeting we look at our members, since we are just starting, and the member database is very very big. So we say okay, let's nominate. Then when we now have larger members, then we can now start proper election after the first 2 days. So members nominated this portfolio. So I want to say that our chairman, Dr. J. Aliasan, sent in his apology. So he sent in his apology. Please, secretary, please take note. He's here with us because he's actually coordinating what is going on before now and up to this moment. Then another thing that we have not been able to do is we have not been able to take advantage of social media. So I want us to, by AOB, we are going to nominate who is going to be our media coordinator, who is going to be responsible for disseminating things that we need to know about our current trends to members. So I think that is that about matters arising from the last minute. So we just go straight to the one of the major items of the agenda, which is the address and monthly lecture by National President. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, join me to welcome our President, Mr. Remy Afon, to the podium.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be in your midst today, and I'm quite excited and happy to be here, but especially to be in the midst of intellectuals. You know, when you come to university environment, you meet intellectuals. That's where the research is being done about what's going to happen in the future, because obviously, we are in the industry, we are dealing with the present, but the people in the academic environment, they are shaping the future, coming up with research and that will bring about development. So it's a pleasure to be here, and I'm quite excited to be in your midst. So it's, what I'm going to do is more like a chat, interactive chat. And I'm just going to talk about the some trends from some trends in cybersecurity, which I'm sure most of you will be familiar with. Then from there we'll discuss about it's not address really. Just more like an interactive lecture. Then talk about the plan that we've got and how the branch can key into that. So we'll be looking at the cybersecurity current trends and threats. You know, if we look at this, we can see that gentleman there who's a security officer. Then we've got that guy in the middle, who is that? What symbol is that? What symbol does that represent?
Cyber protagonist. Cyber negative protagonist.
You look like an ISIS guy.
Yeah.
You know, ISIS has gone cyber now. Yeah. You know. Then we have archivists, the anonymous guys. So, you know, everything has come hand in hand. We have a physical security, the cyber security, and we are looking at terrorism as well. Everything, you know, they work hand in hand. So we'll quickly look at all these security trends. And luckily, we find ourselves in a very good profession, you know. I think most of us are from cyber security department. And the University of Futminna happens to be the only university in Nigeria that offers cyber security at the first degree level. So we are quite lucky to have that here, and which is quite a good thing. And I tell you, you know, cyber security is one of the most lucrative professions in the world. There are millions of job vacancies for cybersecurity experts. At the moment, it might not be the case in Nigeria. I'm not going to lie to you. Because we have a lot of people that got masters in cybersecurity are still looking for jobs because government does not realize the need for cybersecurity. And that's the reason why we formed this association, to make sure that we impress it on government that there's need to protect our cyberspace, protect our enterprise. And by the time government pass some laws that each organization must have minimum control in place, by that time, you know, there will be openings for cybersecurity experts in Nigeria. So, and the new government, they are quite serious about that. And as an association, we are pushing that as well. So, but one thing you need to realize is that you should not be restricted to Nigeria alone. You know, by the time you get your degree, there's opportunity all over the world. So that will start from the beginning as well. From the agenda. So we'll be looking at mobile, Internet of Things, Big Data, Cloud Computing, Social Network, Car Hacking, DDoS, Encryption, and Insider Threat. So we'll start with the mobile one. Apparently everyone has got a phone, I believe. Everyone got a phone?
Yeah, sure.
It looks like a silly question. Even if you go to the market everywhere, you know, in those days, I know phone was something that is only the rich. That's what they call to riot in those days.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those days when M10 started giving us mobile phone, it was a lot of money, but now, you know, it's bad. But it's not only mobile phone, we are talking about, smartphones now. Because apparently what you can do with your computer, you can also do it with your phone. So who can tell me what, you know, it's come with its opportunities and it's come with its threats. Who can tell me one example of the threats that this mobile has come with? Like I said, it's an interactive platform.
The biggest threat, I believe, is that you have no privacy of such.
Yeah.
Again, once you have phone and you are connected to net, it's like you don't have a privacy. What I mean is that for any application you want to use, WhatsApp or whatever, of course, there is that where you are going to or the agreement. And in that agreement, you read it, they will tell you they will have access to photos, your emails, your calls, outgoing, incoming, everything.
Yeah, yeah.
So that invariably it's like you don't have any security, privacy again. Your data, your information is out there.
That's a very major problem, you know, privacy issue. Because obviously they prompt you and say, okay, you just have to accept, you have no choice, because they say they have access to your pictures, they have access to your phone. We were at the University of Abuja to launch the Stockton Connect. I think it was on Wednesday. And one of the issues that came up is that privacy issue. Somebody asked a question about, okay, because she has been prompted all the time about her location. They want her to click yes, that you will be tracking that location. And she said, no. And all the time, there's no option that don't prompt you that question again. So you keep asking, do you want, you know, the app to know your location, you know? But she keep saying no. But there's no option to say, don't prompt me that question again. But when people get tired, they just click yes. And before you know, it tracks wherever you go. The same thing with pictures. You have pictures on your phone. And now with the cloud, things are becoming more nasty, because all your pictures that you have on your phone can get into the cloud, and by the time you get into the cloud, everybody will have access to them. So there's serious privacy issue with mobile. Any other issue that we can take up? Any other threats of vulnerability that mobile has got?
I experienced with the engineering aspect of it.
Okay.
Where you will see somebody who impersonate, because I do ask myself the question, if MTN will send me a text that I should okay or authorize them to use the information of my BVN to make registration, and I don't know how authentic it is, because I look at the message very well sometimes, like this bulk SMS. The sender can customize the link that way. and send the same message to somebody. So it's really an issue because I can't okay that kind of or authorize that kind of transaction because I don't even know, I can't authenticate the sender. That is one issue that I think man is finding it.
Yeah, social engineering is quite common, you know. People just send, they are not what they claim to be. You know, like the BBM you mentioned, it's a very serious issue whereby people say, okay, maybe from Cesar Bank, you have to authenticate this, you have to fill in all this information and so on and so forth. So that's another, if you are talking about bulk SMS, you know, people get your details from different places. And these days, they can send bulk SMS as a kind of phishing to get information from them. So that attackers and hackers are using that as well. Any other threats?
The issue of malware. Because most times when you install some apps, other apps get installed without your knowledge. So after installing the app on your phone, you find out that it comes with other additional apps which could be actually be malware.
Absolutely. Well, as far as I'm concerned, that's number one. Correct. Because malware is a very serious issue. And that's what people use to steal information. You know. People download free apps. You see a lot of apps, free. So why are they benefiting? You don't know that they are trying to install malware on your phone, indirectly, or your system indirectly. You download it, you see all these games. You know, when you download all these games, they come with some malware. They come with those spyware. It might not even be malware, but it's spyware. To get information about you, steal your information. Okay, don't you know, sometimes when you go online, I'm not talking about mobile now, even going back to normal computer or laptop, you know. And you go to a particular site, maybe you are trying to book a ticket or you are trying to buy something. The next time you go online, you'll be seeing adverts from similar things. Because it's the spyware that have sent your data across to them. That this guy likes shopping, he goes to this particular site. This guy likes this, he goes to this. So when he's go online, you now see information that is related to what you are used to. Because they are collecting data about you, about your habits, and sending it to marketers. So malware is a very important one, and it's a very serious one. It's even very common in Nigeria now. The hackers, they are using malware now to steal information. They don't use phishing alone. They combine malware and phishing. In fact, that was a kind of cyber theft that was originated from India. Somebody sent a phishing email to India, and when he got that person filling his information, he stole his credentials, and he discovered that they made a kind of two-factor authentication to be able to log into his account, because when they try to log in, he needs to produce the PIN to be able to log in, which is being generated by the bank sent to your phone, then you'll be able to type it in. So he now sent another malware to that guy's phone in India, and the malware was able to perform a man-in-the-middle attack. So when the guy originated that transaction, want to transfer money from one bank to another, he now prompted him that, okay, put in the PIN, and he sent that PIN to the guy, but the guy didn't see it on his phone because the malware stole that PIN and sent it to that guy in Nigeria, in Lagos. And they were able to steal that. So that's to tell you that, you know, hackers are becoming smarter in Nigeria now. Going are the days that they buy things from the black market. Although they still do that, what they do is that they buy all this malware from this black market, but they have started customizing it as well. So malware is a very big one. Any other threats on the mobile?
I think another one is loss of or theft of the phone itself.
Yes, that's a big one, loss of theft. So how do we protect it against loss of or theft of the phone? So if somebody steals my phone now, and it's, you know, our phone contains virtually everything about us. Your phone has got, you know, if somebody steals my phone now, and they are able to go into it, you go into my Yahoo mail straight, you go into my Facebook, you go into my Twitter. So I'd like, how do we protect against that? How can one protect against that?
I think mostly it can, if you can initiate a remote work.
Absolutely. Remote work, that's what most organizations do. And even you as well. You can mostly back it away. Then there's a, you can encrypt it as well. You encrypt it so that, you know, even if they steal it, there is no way to do it. And it's not all about mobile phone alone. You know, when we are talking about mobile, we are talking about laptop as well. Because they're quite mobile, you are not in the office, you are working somewhere else. That's mobile working. So people work from home, you work remotely. If you lose your laptop, you contest sensitive information about the organization you work for. So what's going to happen? So one of the best practices is to make sure there is encryption on that laptop. So that if somebody steals it, they can't even do anything about it. And most of these, like McAfee, antivirus, so they have encryption solution that you can put on your laptop. So once it's stolen, you can remotely wipe it off as well. So all this malware that we mentioned, what are the countermeasures? How do you protect against them? Like all this malware, I don't want malware to be on my, I don't want to download malware. What do I do? How do I protect myself? And this privacy of the team, you know, that someone mentioned, how do I maintain privacy? What are the countermeasures? Okay, we're talking about threats. There's no point talking about threats without talking about how to protect yourself. So how do I protect myself? Let's assume someone come and meet you and say, okay, I know you're a cyber security expert. I don't want to have malware on my phone. How do I protect myself?
No, I may not have the answer to the capital aspect, but I know when they say something is free, I must be right, and I'll ask. There's one, somebody that told me before that if somebody says something is free, somebody is paying for it. Nothing is free in this world. So if an app is free for you, and you know that definitely something might creep in when you download it, so if you don't download it,
I don't think all apps that I've seen have malicious intent. So I think what people can do to protect themselves is to always read information that have been prompted to them. Because most people, most Nigerians anyways, you see the list of information that they want you to agree to. They don't bother reading terms and conditions. Or something prompts you, you see yes, no, you just click on yes. So those things actually are requesting for your permission. So if you take time to read those information, you can protect yourself. Like the lady who was constantly being prompted that she should agree to allegation of being trapped, agree to allegation of being trapped. She took time to actually read it. Now, so she was able to mitigate that for a certain number of times before she got there. So people don't have read it. So they won't even be aware that they are being trapped. So people should take time to read prompts on their phones, on their laptops, before just clicking yes or no.
Yeah, that's fine. But what about it's a malware app. So they're not going to tell me it's a malware app. Even if I need it. How do I?
I think the confidence option is don't accept what you're not too detailed about. Save all issues. Don't accept this to say yes. To accept. Before you're putting your phone, you must do an acceptance. But I think it's better don't accept what you do not have details. That's safe. I think they even read it by even prompted, but don't do accept. If you know they don't know what to do,
just so, apart from the terms and conditions, I think just as it applies to laptops, I think it also applies to some phones, if not all phones. Just as they used to create antiviruses that protect the system against all this, especially in respect to what the first person said. The issue of terms and conditions, accepting prompts before you actually go ahead to install the program. There are protective software like mobile antiviruses that could be installed, which can actually mitigate and protect the system from malware.
Yeah, thank you.
We
have all
the
contributed excellently. And the first two or three people that are talking about, don't accept this, don't click on that, don't download or anything that is free. It's all about user awareness. Yeah.
user awareness, you know, people should be aware that all these things exist. And, you know, they should know that when you are being sent a link, you don't just click on it. Like you said, read information. It's not only Nigerians that don't read. Everybody reads, but people don't read. Because these people, they make things difficult for you. They send a very long list of terms and conditions. Who has got time to read it? You just click OK. Myself, too, I click OK unconsciously without. You know, like, why did I do this? I didn't even take time to read. So, you know, we have to start embedding that culture of trying to understand what it's all about. You see a free, you know, a free app on the net. Yeah, it's not all apps that are free that are malicious, but take time to study that. Have you read anything about that app? Have you? And Google makes that easier. Just Google about that particular app and get some information about the app before you start downloading or installing it. I'm sure a lot of people will have written some review about that particular app. And if it's new, why not wait to get to know more about that app before you start to download it? So that's the mobile. I think the next one is the Internet of Things. That's a buzzword now. A lot of people are talking about it. Internet of Things. Wow. Who can tell us what's Internet of Things? Is anybody doing that? Have you got any final year students here? Or masters students?
Yeah.
That are working on this
very year masters.
Okay. Okay, you don't have an undergraduate. How come? You can bring it to the younger generation. Ah, that's fine. It's fine. Yeah. We need the younger guys, you know. You have to stop it. That's to be your quest. Yeah. I think somebody contacted me after some time to do that. Internet of Things. Is anybody doing their testing on that? So what's your mind? Tell us about what you are working on.
Actually, I just started
doing it
for you. Okay. But what I will do is just a scenario connected things, like Bluetooth devices, equipment, and sensors, like ceramics. To perform certain actions. For example, I think one aspect of me that got my internet was a smartphone. Where you have devices connected and discussing and creating, using sensors, you're able to detect and send information. That's really important for you as well.
So Internet of Things, because like she rightly said, a collection of different things. So obviously, because internet is involved, you know, it passes through the internet or connection as well. So you can remotely control them wherever you want. And a good example I give is, for instance, maybe I live in Guadalajara now. You know, and on my way back home, I go to Guadalajara now, it's very hot. And I want the house to be cold by the time I get there. I just keep my smartphone and remotely switch on my AC. Because if I get into the room, it takes a while for it to get cold. So I can just remotely make my AC to be switched on. And by the time I get to it's going to be cold. So you can remotely do a lot of things, you know, using the Internet of Things. But well, it comes with its own vulnerability as well, you know, because it can be hard, basically, but with like any other thing. So you can tell us some sort of the vulnerabilities that
I think it's like a wristwatch or a wristband. that takes your, that you're able, that is able to take your blood pressure, take your details about you. This information can actually be used without your knowledge. So they are in your privacy issue. And
yeah.
We also have access issues.
Yeah, that's good. That's privacy issue is one of the things, because most of this information are sent unencrypted over the internet. So people can easily steal those information. Thereby, somebody can just do a kind of manual attack and steal all the information. They can even take information about it. But there's a particular one now we're going to get into. This is where we can hack the car. The car has people that are mostly cause accidents. So, you know, people, like in Nigeria now, who can give me a good example of the kind of things that we are using? In my table, we have not gone there, but we are still at this. So car tracker, that's another, example of internet of things, because you can remotely know the location of the car, and you can remotely lock that car. There are some other organizations that offer that kind of service. Now, when you install it in your car, and you also can remotely lock that car. Another example that somebody gave was, CCTV that can be installed and use your internet to monitor whatever is there. But the only thing is that why I didn't agree with you is that there's no way you can perform an operation remotely without CCTV. You are just tracking, you are monitoring. So it's not that you are performing any operation remotely, and it doesn't have any sense for it. Obviously, it's an example. As time goes on, this technology will get to that level whereby you can. And we have smart homes now. You know, we are talking about smart homes. Yeah. We have smart homes now.
Actually, somebody, I happened to attend one of the program, and the instructor was trying to tell us that he designed one software program in which, if, for example, they are forgotten to shut down the doors and cut it off the doors, you can just remotely do that. So I don't really know actually how to but it was trying to.
That's it. Okay, that's not true. Whether she did, whether he did that or not.
Because he was saying that here in Binama, that was what he was trying to do to tell us.
Okay.
But here in Binama, he himself has done something.
Something similar. Okay. Yeah, that's the kind of thing. Yeah. You can remotely, because smart homes remotely switch on your light, remotely switch off your lights. Remote is not So, but it's come with its own, because people can hack all these things. For instance, you know, like a baby monitor.
that uses the internet, and people can monitor their baby. You can be in another room, your baby sleeping in another room, and you'll be able to monitor that baby if she cries, you pick the voice and you hear it like a speaker, you hear it in your room, and you'll be able to see the picture of that baby and monitor. But it's just recently, that has been hacked. So you see that, you still see your baby there as if she's sleeping or he. And they just kidnap that baby. So the essence of so because it's where IP address, it's where everything, so people can just remove people to that.
There's a
kind of
issue. Yes. Yeah. Kind of that so they check where the phone is from. So if you know that the customer factory is coming from that factory,
and the one means are getting chips on their bodies. so that they can track them. This Obama care is coming up in America now. And some people are saying the world is coming to an end.
That's
if you look at it from the religious point of view, that when the world is coming to an end, a lot of things will be happening. So like these embedded chips are, rather than use your card, you can use the chips that are. So that's the internet of things.
For you. I'm interested in this internet of things.
Okay.
Actually, what I want to do actually is the fact that when we're talking about IP machine, we're talking about trying to look at the investments of the IP itself. So now, do we have IP machines? Only the technology that this very internet of things is actually working to actually have something.
Yeah, it uses both IP, the most important is for you to have the IP. What kind of argument?
Okay. I mean, because since for a particular system or an aspect, for example, now from previous that you have flash drives, other small companies, we are going to communicate with other companies. It means that for them to be able to communicate, there has to be a particular IP. So which one are they really using that we're able to have?
As many as
yes.
Yeah, IP 6, like right there, which extended the IPs ability. And IP 4 as well, you can still use IP 4 and they can communicate with each other.
So the issue that you talk about, the issue of the security, are those IPs not, versions of IPs that don't have their own security? Or the IP that whenever you have to establish the connection, you have to also adopt maybe an aspect of security.
The problem is that these guys, when they come with new technology, sometimes you know that the technology, they think about security. They don't think about security, and they multiply wrong. And that's why people in the information security profession are saying, before you roll out any technology, think about security first. So you see, all this, when you come out with any software, it's after that you discover that this technology, they're not coming up with patches all the time. Because they are in the hurry, they are marketers, they are in a hurry to roll out stuff. And that's the same thing with this Internet of Things. It's quite a lot of vulnerabilities in it. Like the one I mentioned, sending the same text rather than the encryption. And so, because it makes it easier. So, by the time they embed security, it becomes more complex, it becomes more difficult. So, they don't really think about security. Really.
So, you're not going to see from the inception of the implementation, we're going to find a bit among society working on this very important level. So, maybe you can ask yourself, maybe your host, maybe if the students want to work on the parent media, how can you maybe advise them? And how would you advise them? What area? you advise a particular student who wants to actually contribute to the in this very area to actually
where they have reached and what else is the limit? So even where they have reached, is there any fault you can bring out? So if there is fault, maybe in terms of security, you may want to bring that little loophole, you want to block it. You have added something. Or where they have stopped, you can take it a little bit further.
So you have to first of all understand what that kind of vulnerability can be eradicated, so to speak, or minimized. So when you come up with that kind of solution, that's the research. So we move on to the big data. What's big data? We know about database. So what about big data? So what's so big about data now? And then everybody is just talking about it. Is anyone doing any research?
I'm not doing any research on big data, I just know a little about it. I think because of the number of devices we have these days, a lot of data is being generated. So big data is dealing with how to maybe aggregate those data and use them, make good use of them. Like you mentioned, some companies, they use this big data to know your preferences, like the kind of sites you visit, the kind of products you go to look at those sites. Maybe where you normally travel to, so they can suggest which airlines are going to school. That's one of the uses of big data.
So big data does, you know, aggregating a lot of information together and be able to make forecasts, make decisions, things like that. You know, we discover that a lot of data that are being generated, that people don't even use at all. People don't restrict to restrict their use to that of the relational database and, you know, just for the organizational use. So what about other data that has been generated by the site? So they now come about with this big data of things whereby they can do a lot of research and link everything together, whether it's for, because they know at the end of the day they are going to be able to make sense out of it. And you see some people, that's what they specialize in. Data mining, data analysis, and a good example is this analytics. It's very common now. You know, we have what's called Google Analytics. Organization to see people when they go to their websites, just to do the analysis. It's just a simple example of big data for that. It's much more beyond that. So that's an area now for research. Who can tell us about what kind of vulnerability do you think that might happen? Okay, what are the vulnerabilities that we have in the database? The normal relational database, what are the vulnerabilities? Like in Nigeria now, we are generating, a lot of organizations are taking a lot of information.
interested. I wanted to collect the SIM card. I wanted to buy a SIM card about 2 days ago. I'm asking for my fingerprint, taking my pictures, all this personality. You go to those institutions, you have to take all the give them all this your personality. You go to INEC, you give them all this your personality. You go to hotel, you want to lunch, you give them all your personality. Who's keeping all this data? You understand? Why are we having all this data all scattered all over? Why can't we have a single data center that captures every? And that's the reason why you see in some developed world, they have a national insurance number. Everybody has to assume you need to know. So if I go there, what I need is just my last name and all my information will pull up. And that, why do people use, if you want to lodge in hotel, why do they say you pay prefer? Even if you have cash, they'll say you should use your credit card. Because they know it links up to all your information. So everybody don't just have to start collecting the data. Why will it disallow us to collect my data? All that's available. What's the protection that they are putting on? On those data they're collecting. It's not those guys that just in one kiosk and collect your information. And these are money. People don't know all this information. You know, by the time they gather all this information, they can come up with a lot of this information. These are data that people, personal data that people steal to commit crime. What do you say something?
No, I'm annoyed with MTN. They are still requesting for the fifth time.
For your list?
Exactly. MTN is one.
So there is a particular law now that we need to work on as an administration, you know, this data protection. There is no data protection for anything. So if anybody is working in that particular area, for thesis or master's or whatever, that's an area that the association is quite interested in, to work with the National Assembly and come up with law for data protection. It's quite important. You know, even if you protect your data, people are stealing it. Recently, the hackers, they go to FBI to steal 20,000 personal information of FBI staff, 20,000, and they publish it on the internet for everybody to see. They don't even sell it to the black market. They tell you that, okay, you claim you are FBI, you got a lot of security police, they move it and hack the system. So, and they've got a lot of good protection in place. How much more we than we just give everybody our data.
But data might be secure. Put any of these things. So, this is the question about the
Your phone number,
your address, those confirm this list. If you need a phone, go there and pay those security guys for your personal use.
That is what people get. You know, those information, that's what the hackers are looking for. The hackers are looking for your email address. They are looking for your phone number. To be able to send a phishing link to you. So that when they send it to you, you will not know, you think it's from a credit source, you take from you and you get it. And they use this particular software to do that, to harvest the email address. They use harvester to do that. Online, you just harvest a lot of email addresses for them, and they send these letters in bulk. So for this one to, for them to just go to this and give them $500 or $1,000, they just pay a lot of money. So you don't need to start.
For the condition, if you want to appeal for money, just get that.
So I think someone should work on that data protection. It's a very important one. Someone should do a research in that area. As it pertains to Nigerians, I should be able to come up with a law and propose also that bill to the National Assembly. But I'm not necessarily being a research. It might be somebody that's got interest in that particular area. So let's work together on that, get people to move into that area. Then we'll be able to propose it to the National Assembly, sponsor that bill, individuals can sponsor this. And that's one of the reasons why we set up this association. So that we just sit down and criticize the government. Let's do something about it.
by the time we present to the government, we know that. Send it to the National Assembly. Talk to the presidency. This is what I've committed to. Get the press to know about it. The National Assembly is not doing anything about it. Continue to make noise that, okay, are you guys expecting us to bribe you before you start doing all this? And before you know it, you will start doing that. Because nobody is going to do that for us. We are the ones that are supposed to be doing this. We call ourselves advocacy group. So anything that is related to cyber security is our job to do that. So cloud computing, another interesting area, and we have mentioned it when we are talking about mobile phone and mobile vulnerabilities. Cloud. Like any other technology, cloud came and nobody thought about security. But now, you know, we now have an association now, you know, like a certification body that does cloud security. They are called CSA, Cloud Security Alliance. You know, people, if you want to specialize, that's an area somebody can specialize in. You can specialize in cloud security. It's an area of cyber security as well. So, who's doing anything on cloud security? Or who's got interest? And they are, you know, as a matter of interest, they are looking into cloud security.
We have a student working in Apex.
It's not around now. So what is this cloud about? Say that's sky.
Well, cloud is just a better for internet. It's when you access your information. That's from the it is a model for assessing your resources from the internet.
So now what this cloud is all about, you know, it came about when organization discovered that okay. It's like we are spending a lot of money to have our own data center, we are spending a lot of money to have our which we cannot really afford. Rather than invest that so much. Why not have a kind of shared resources? You know, or put it, so some organization they have services in the cloud. What they do is that they provide the service and you now, you know, you go and buy that service from them. So you can buy applications. You don't own it, you are just running their own application. You can buy infrastructure, you know, on the internet. You don't own it, but they are running it for you and you know. And in some cases you might be linked with some other organization, you are sharing all those things. You know, all these things, they come with their own risk as well. Because who's going to take responsibility of what? The privacy of the state, that might be breached. So all these things have to be stated in the contract. And some people are going about private cloud as well. That's being owned by your own organization, you know. So that's what we call infrastructure as a service, you know, application as a service, as well as things. So depending on what you really want, you know, software as a service. So what do you really want to define that? Because cloud is quite wide. Okay, we just want to be running our application in the cloud. We own the, you know, we own the infrastructure. Or we don't own the infrastructure, we want to run everything in the cloud. And now cloud technology is coming up. In those days, all the security devices are always like hardware. For instance, like I want to give a good example of a secure web gateway. Secure web gateway is something that you use to protect your organization from going to the internet. When people browse, maybe the users, there's some websites that are malicious, it just blocks them. Or the email that are coming in, it blocks those emails. A good example is the WebSense, which are so many products.
Firewalls.
This one, it works like an application firewall, but it's not really blocking ports per se. We're just blocking the web internet, browsing, and so on and so forth. Maybe you don't want people to go to a particular site. Like, you can configure it, maybe you don't want people... Obviously, when people are working, you don't expect them to be going to like pornographic sites. So all those times will be blocked. By the time you want to go into it, you are going against the organization policy. And it's going to log it. Send it to the security department, you know that this guy is going to a dodgy website. So, in those days they use equipment, you connect it to your server, you know. But now, there's a cloud solution for that. Everything is just in the cloud. And so many other security solutions as well.
But it comes with its own, threats. Who can tell us? What are the vulnerabilities and threats of this cloud?
The most obvious one is privacy.
Privacy, yeah. Because you are giving it to a third party. So this third party now, are you sure, what's the assurance that, because even in your own organization there is inside that threat, how much more the third party that you are outsourcing all this thing to? Any other one?
Promote denial service.
Well, so what's the assurance for business continuity? What's the business continuity if there's, what's the disaster recovery? If the cloud goes down, the cloud where they go down, how do you continue? So well, you have to factor this thing in. Otherwise you'll be out of business. That's what businesses that if they are down for like 30 minutes, that's the end of it. Because they make money on a regular basis and the site cannot afford to be down.
Like some software is saying, you need to buy the software, just connect it to the cloud and run it for your organization. Pay a certain type of amount for that amount.
Yes.
Really good cheaper. If I have $50, I'm using that kind of software. Kind of software. You have to buy how many pounds. Then I can buy one and pay $50 per month.
Yes.
And use it. So why do I just do it? It's really loyal to that. And then they shut down the cloud. Then the business is crashed.
Then you lose access.
Imagine a bank, for instance, bank is okay for you to do anything, post it in Tela. Tela application is in the cloud. So if there's any chance for us to deal with bank, shut down or deal with that aspect of their bank, then for the whole day they can put it in Tela. So what's the sense?
Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah, okay. They have denial of service. That's very good. Like that one. So that's a cloud for you.
I don't know about you.
So we talk about the mobile, the cloud, and the big data. So, I mean, is this just a summary of all the things that we have mentioned? Talking about the risk, the benefits that is involved in that. Mm-hmm. Another thing now is the social network. The social network. How many of us are on social media? Oh, sorry. How many of us are not? Because I know almost everybody. That's the better question. How many of us are not on the social network? A friend of mine came yesterday. He told me the only thing he has on is Twitter. It's not on Facebook. It's not anything. So how many of us are not on any social media at all?
Impossible.
And the only way we interact is physically or make by phone call. How many of us are not on any social media?
Well, it's possible.
That's the thing
Connect launch we did.
Mm.
One of the big shots said it's not in the media.
Yeah. Okay. So all of us are on. So how many of us are on Facebook? Just wave your hand. You are not.
I believe everyone.
It might not be. I said some people are not on Facebook. Okay, everyone is on Facebook.
Mm.
How many of us are on Twitter?
Yes.
Just only one person. Everyone, all of you. How many of us are on LinkedIn? How many of us are on
WhatsApp?
No, WhatsApp. How many of us are on Instagram? Just only one person. Are you on Instagram? Okay, how many of us are on Snap? How many of us do Snapchat? So we are getting down to We are getting down to the new generation way of thinking. You know, our old Facebook, when Facebook came, our generation picked it and Gram and the new generation now, what they do now is the Snapchat, which is quite even different from, and I believe most people
We are talking about teenagers and below. That's the area they grow. Yeah. And they are wiser than us. They are even more security conscious than us. Because Snapchat, because of the privacy in it, because when you use Snapchat, it just is always there for like 48 hours and you get wiped up. Mm-hmm. But when you post on Facebook, it's there forever. Even if you delete it, it's still there.
What is happening somewhere?
You know, sir, it's still in their server somewhere because they back up. Their backup is like every minute. So obviously, if they want to get information about it, they say, people say they delete, they tweet, and they mistakenly say, ah, I shouldn't have tweeted this. But somebody else has retweeted what you have tweeted. So even if you remove it, what about the retweet? How many people? Actually, people that have a lot of followers. So social network, it's got its own benefits. We reach people easily. We can do marketing easily. And I believe all of us are like our page, the Cyber Security Expert page on Facebook. You've not come across it?
Yeah.
We've got a page. And it's very important for you to like that page. Like our page to Twitter, follow us on Twitter and which other one? LinkedIn. We have a LinkedIn. And the reason why we create all these things is for us to be able to reach ourselves quickly and reach it. And I'm from the agenda, Mr. Chairman, from that agenda, I discovered that you are looking at getting somebody that will
be media coordinator.
Media coordinator. Yes. So that's going to be the social media strategist.
Absolutely.
Okay, when I had a meeting with the Abuja people as well, I said, somebody, we need somebody to volunteer as that and let us know whoever you guys nominate as a social media strategist. That person is going to be managing with some other people because we're having a team of social media within the association. So these people will be managing our Facebook, our Twitter, and LinkedIn. We are here to go to Instagram and Snapchat.
What are the
vulnerabilities or the threats that this one comes with? Social media.
I think privacy thing because I ask myself a question, the owner of Facebook, because I always read about some controversy between Facebook and the US government.
Yes.
Some people will be accusing him of taking their data, as a story that has been giving the US government their data. There's a kind of issue.
Yes.
There are people always lamenting and things that are around. Because it's across the whole world now. The US government can have my information.
Yes.
If I provide my information, say likewise with their data. So the alliance between the government and them is not something we really trust. In as much as we need to have or to have privacy standard or whatever, still that privacy thing, we are not too sure.
Absolutely. Are people voluntarily give their information?
That's what I wanted to say. Because privacy in social media is for you. You have to take your privacy important to you. Somebody wakes up in the morning and says they are waking up. He goes to brush his teeth, he says he's brushing his teeth. He wants to go to the bank, he says I'm going to the bank, take a picture with the ATM, maybe one person is so it's not Facebook who has to give it away, you have to give it away yourself. There was an issue with one of my neighbors and her husband's mom. She took pictures of their 18-year-old baby and put it on the internet.
Picture of what?
18-year-old baby.
Okay, 18-year-old baby. Okay.
Took a picture, put it on Facebook, and people were congratulating me. I said, what if someone is going to take the picture and go and do it? And the guy did it. She changed the baby.
Oh, so they said somebody.
The mom of the husband said, somebody can download that picture now.
Okay, okay.
That
but they didn't download it, but they didn't do that.
So there's a big change.
That's a possibility, but there's no scientific backing that. But what I'm saying is that there's no scientific backing that when you download a picture, you put something on top of it. That check will come
in. Yes. It's good that we give up our information.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's not an issue with Facebook, but we're not trying to give up even sensitive information. Somebody can use NIC and snap to the NIC data certificate on Facebook. Somebody can easily download this.
His number and everything.
His number, use and do whatever. If he wants to.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, privacy is a very key one. Because people voluntarily give volunteer information. I'm traveling to Mina. I'm going to Mina for about a day for 3 days. Put it there. I'm not about to know I'm not going to leave my house. So it's an opportunity for them to go. So another
I thought a very key one that the society is not taking cognizance of his course. As in, something is not real, and some people just post it on social media, and in most some cases, it can even eventually lead to death. Like when Ebola broke out in Nigeria, salt water, and some people died, as in, taking excess salt. Whereas the beans, as in the source of using salt to cure or to prevent Ebola, cannot be traced to any physician or medical expert. So, but social media was used as a platform to disseminate such a cause.
So social media can be used to disseminate the very false information, misleading information. People just, like the one you rightly said, use it during Ebola. And some people say, when you have Apollo use battery water. I think when you see that on social media, and a lot of fake news on the internet, people come with fake news as well. Fake profiles. I'm the customs officer. I'm selling these cars. You have an issue. Did you pay someone?
I've checked car costs of car times ago, and somebody is just looking at every. If I'm on my Yahoo now, just see advert for cars, customer visit. And if anyone's going to that name and that detail never exists.
Of course.
So if I update that, if I have used that transaction to follow up, I may have been speaking, but today, this is 10 million chats. So my mind said, okay, that can also be an opportunity for the things to explore. Especially on the effect of what you think of business. You can explore that and then
do it. Yeah, absolutely. It should be part of the campaign where you go out to tell people about stopping
projects.
So, recently somebody created a profile on Fashion App on Facebook and started collecting money from people. It's going to give them employment. We've seen cases where people create fake email and websites.
Who
are
admission?
Yeah, admission. So, social media, it comes with its advantages. And, so, car hacking, that one has got data now. You know, I'm talking about it, you know, people. You can easily remotely hack cars. In fact, this was demonstrated during the last Black Hat conference in America, whereby you can remotely control a brake. So if you hack into that car, you can, and you want that car to have accidents, you remotely automatically apply that brake while that person is traveling. Or you can remotely deflate the tire. You know, most of even we have them in Nigeria, cars that are using Android operating system. And you know, Android as well is quite vulnerable to all this. So when it's okay, you've got the. This still have become, you know, this technology has been coming gradually, but people don't know about it, you know. When it's okay, we have a brain box that's controlling all this. So there's a way, now it's got operating systems that comes with it. So if you have a operating system, I can remotely hack into it and do whatever you want to do.
So there's a positive listing. There are some oil-privileged companies, including so, managing their trucks. Like Conoil. It was about time of the day that Conoil truck, you know, which they have, anywhere they have, From 6:30 PM as down the road. But that time every of our wherever you are in the area, with just enough of our impact. So yeah, maybe I driver you must make sure you are within a particular town to make sure that time it will be. If you are near the bush and then they shut you down, there are the following day. You can't come and claim what call it, this travel
allowance.
If the record is showing you, but no way, I'm allowing you at any time at 6:30, all trucks must park. If you, that's it, I travel 5 in the road.
So it's got its advantage, it's got its own disadvantage. If somebody hack into their system, they can easily be like, all these car trucks, they always lose their job. Like, if you stole your car, and it has a track at inside, if you put it on your track, but if you do switch off, then you get to call your track. That's why they like introduce the issue of COVID. If you stole your car, you have to give it, if you track your car, they give a code and send it to you all night for
okay.
To stop immediately. No code. Some engineers. They use SIM cards.
SIM
cards. They use a particular network to track it. And any of the network we use in Nigeria.
Okay, because they've got
a BNE, yes.
Base station.
Our big guy from this.
Yes, sir.
So, ATM. Now they're giving out money these days. You know, we have a bottomless card. You just slot it into the and money will be coming out. People are using malware to steal money. Free money. Who can tell me why that is? Why is it? Why is it that hackers are able to steal money from the cash box? I think the major reason is because, you know, they use operating system as well. And most the operating system, most of these ATM users are outdated, they are for example, Windows SP. There are too many ATM that are using, and that's no longer being supported by Microsoft. So obviously, hackers will know the vulnerabilities there, and they are going to exploit it. Then we have the DDoS attack. That's another common attack coming up. Well, what's the DDoS attack? You can quickly define that for denial of service. How does it happen? How do you?
Based on this this is a post attack. He makes this zombie compromise that system to attack that system over there. They don't know that system is being compromised. So we will now use this system acting as a zombie to attack and most it's crash down the system.
Absolutely. So that's a simple analysis. You got the attacker, you are using, you compromise one system, from this system you compromise it. So you have a lot of compromised systems that are called zombies. Then you have a victim somewhere that you want to crash. Then you now be sending packets from different one. And the request is going to be so much for that one, you won't be able to handle it and it crashes. If it's just a single system that is sending the gas in the line of service attack, but if you have so many systems, that what we call distributed in the line of service attack, and they are called all the zombies collectively, they are called botnets. So this is a very common one now. You see people generating those attacks because it's quite easy. There are some commands that will just issue and just know the website. And you'll be able to bring it down. And so it's quite important that organizations put in place controls that can block all these denial services. And these are the common, you have a SIP loss, you have the TCP loss, HTTP loss, ICMP, and UDP. But the most common one is the SIP. You all know about this. Three-way handshake. You can tell us three-way handshake. Has anyone got like
networking background. Three-way handshake. Three-way handshake is all about sending a request from the sender, the receiver accepts, but you have to acknowledge that you accept it as receiver. Send the acknowledgement back, and you have to send it back again as well. So that's not what three-way handshake. And that's what normally happens when you are giving the request, maybe you blast with a dollar website, then you get the feedback back. You are sending the request, you are receiving the request, bringing back the page for you. So, what attackers do is that they send enough sync. That's a request. Yeah. And by the time it's too much, the website will not be able to handle it and it brings it down. But the aim of the attacks is not really to bring down the website, to be able to steal it from you. Once it's done, you don't know if you don't get a spender, and now you're going to go into your server and steal your information. So encryption is another, you know, big thing coming up. How many of us have heard about this ransom malware? Ransom malware. It encrypts your system and asks you to pay a particular amount of money. Okay. Now, if you pay that money, they will give you the code to unlock it. That's the latest cyber attack that's taking place now. Just about 2 weeks ago, in the United Kingdom, there is Lincolnshire County Council. Hackers, they are just teenagers. They encrypt the whole of their system, their servers, in that country. And told them, pay us £1 million, then we'll give you the code. They held them to run for like 3 weeks. I don't know how that ended. Maybe they were able to negotiate. But you know, the government, the FBI, the CIA, the MI5, they are trying to pay it. You know, this guy, they don't care. They flock it and you lose all the information. It might be cheaper for you to pay the ransom. So that's another thing coming up. And how do you pay them? It's not that you can pay the cash and say, okay, come and meet me inside one bush. They bring those things. They give me, drop the box, and we leave you. You pay it in the dark net. You know about dark net? You know, we are on the surface net, like we Google all this internet, which is the surface one. But there's a dark net. Dark net is the black market of the internet, where the criminal gangs are there. You know, and that's why they sell, you know, there's a Bitcoin now that they use. That's the currency they use in the darknet. You can't go to the darknet online. You need to install a particular software called Tigora. And this thing is Onion, dot Onion, you know, instead of .com, it's dot Onion. But you need to know that particular website you want to go. If you want to go to a place whereby you need an assassin, you want to buy to pay from the you go to that particular website. If you want to buy gun, you go to that particular website. So, but ordinarily on the internet you can't get there. They have a special browser you need to install. And so, and there's special money we spend there, which is called Bitcoin. So if they want ransom from you and they give you equivalent in naira or dollars or what, you pay the value of the Bitcoin. So that's what's taking place. Yeah, and that's where Nigerian criminal gangs are buying their malware anyway. They send malware there as well. Who has seen this guy before?
Snowden.
Edward Snowden.
Yeah.
What's that about him? What has he done? That's so popular in the information security world.
Snowden leaker.
Yeah?
He leaked secrets.
He leaked the secrets of America to Russia.
As in
the guy's enjoying in Russia now. This guy is a security cleared consultant for American security agency. And based on that, he's got access to a lot of privileged information. All what he did is get a USB and store a lot of information in it and took it to Russia. Leak. So there's insider threat, that's a bad, another very big threat. Because people that you employ in the organization, they can be the weakest link. Because obviously, they can
can steal information within the environment, or they can unknowingly supply information as well. It might not be intentionally they are doing this, but they are supplying information about it. So that's another big threat that we have to be aware of. And instead of all the scary things that can sabotage the network, this one is by far the deadliest. 80% of security problems are caused by network problems. As a matter of fact, this slide is now outdated because I think about 4 weeks ago, the report came out asking security professionals which one is the most, you know, what kind of vulnerabilities can you top, take as the highest vulnerability. And 90% of people that responded said it's the people, the social engineering, because people, they are vulnerable. People can, somebody can just trick you to supply your information. Somebody can claim to be nice, and before you know it, you get all your information. They claim that they're trying to help you. You know, you see an email from the bank, you think, you know, your BVN, otherwise your account will be locked. Before you know it, you supply. You know, so people are the weakest thing, and that's the reason why the most important thing now is the security awareness, which, you know, to let people know the dangers that are there. So what's the way forward? How do we make sure that these are the security awareness? That's number one. It's very key. And organizations spend a lot of money on this. Universities need to spend money about it as well. We need to start making the student aware. And that's the responsibility of us as the cyber security experts. A lot of students there, they just go on the internet, they don't know. People just might find that it is the University of Technology, but they still need to understand. And you know, even the lecturers. Lecturers also bring you guys to have to make sure that your colleagues understand the dangers, you know. Because I tell you, very soon students will be hacking into your and changing the results. They'll give themselves a very good mark. It's started happening in some other part of the world. So you need to your laptops that you store information about the student results, are they encrypted? Any laptop that the lecturer is going to be using, the university must make sure that it's encrypted. Because if it's stolen or somebody hacked into it, and what kind of, regularly patched, are they part of the system? So all these things are very important. Otherwise, the hackers are going to, you know, get into that. So general security assessment and penetration tests, from time to time, you check your state of security and get external people to come and do penetration tests and see what. If there is any incident that occurs, do a digital forensic and incident response quickly to be online and learn some lessons from there. How many of us are doing research on forensic? So that's another interesting area. It's quite important. So it's quite complicated to be, it's a very big job. You see, CISO, Chief Information Security Officer. This organization. So where do I start from? Where do I do a lot of technology, business functions? So how do I secure the organization? So it's become simplified. They are simplified now because these days the management just wants to see the dashboard where you give information about what's happening. So what do you need? These are what you need to do. Have a user access management in place. Block any spareware. And remove them. So that means you will have a software that does that for you. And the spareware that can do that. IT asset management, before you can protect your assets, you need to understand what you have got in place. Because you can't protect what you don't know. So what are the assets that you've got? What is the criticality? How are they critical to your business? That will inform the kind of protection. Patch regularly. Patch management must be in place, you want to patch it from time to time. It doesn't necessarily mean you do it, but that's your job as a security officer to make sure that you do vulnerability assessment. What are the patches missing? Make sure the IT department patches it. Application blocking, anybody cannot just bring the application and install it on the system. You must be able to block the applications that are not authorized. So you have a list of authorized applications within your organization. And anybody that wants to install the one that is not authorized, you have blocked. Connection control, anybody cannot just plug anything into the system. You know, the USB now, when you plug it, you can contain malware. People are using that social engineering. They just drop the USB into an organization. Somebody will pick it, plug it into their system, and
before internet. It's possible, you don't need to be connected to internet to stay there. That, that's the reason why when the former INEC chairman said, we are not connected to internet, so nobody can hack us.
I just laughed and said, well,
that's the level of your understanding. People can hack you anyway. And all what you need is just access to your system, your server. And you know, if you, I'm sure if I throw one fanciful USB stick inside my neck, not far from where they are, if someone will quickly plug it to their system.
To even just
see. My mind was downloaded on that system. I still know the information they are talking about. You know, so that happened in Iran, actually. You know, the nuclear plants they have, America want to steal information about them. And they throw somebody, they throw the USB there, they plug into their system. And then this particular malware called Stocknet, I don't know whether it's now. Stocknet. That was how they got that malware planted on there and they steal their information. So it's quite important to make sure that all these device controls are in place. You can block the USB there, and you can plug it to it. Then you have network access control. Not everybody can plug their devices on your network. Antivirus, that's very important. And not only installing antivirus, making sure that the signatures are up to date. And antivirus monitoring and enforcement. Periodic independent security testing, we have mentioned that. You get external people to come and test your security. Secure system implementation, if you are going to cloud or you are installing new applications, are they securely used? You have to put that in the consideration. And then lastly, but not the least of these, intrusion detection and intrusion prevention. These are coming in. You need to know what kind of traffic are coming in, which one am I going to allow, which one am I going to be talking about the firewall the other time.
Yeah.
You know, all these things are so in place. So there is a very shortage of cyber security skills. There's a skills crisis in the world now. And luckily, you guys are into cyber security profession, so I guarantee you that, you know, at least ISACA came up with this analysis just 2014, and 2016 is getting, you know, becoming a crisis now. About 1 million field security jobs. Not like, but now it's getting close to 2 million. A lot of people advertise a lot of jobs and they don't see people to fill it. So, but Nigeria is here to get there. We are going to get there. And by the time we get there, it now becomes a crisis because we are not prepared. The workforce that we need to prepare, we are not doing that. It's only the vast Futminna that is producing graduates in cybersecurity. So, I do want to fill all those vacancies that we have, that we don't come, because very soon organizations will now wake up and say, oh, we need to protect our system. You know, we normally leave this to the last minute. You know, when terrorism was coming up, so, you know, all of a sudden we woke up and said, okay, and we started pumping money into it. And Dasuki Gate has come up. So we don't let us get to that Dasuki Gate level before we start. But obviously, I brought a good news for you that, you know, guys, we are in a very good profession and there is a skill crisis in the world. And even if the NG has not provided a job for you, we are guaranteed of the job somewhere that they know your value. So I hope I've not brought you. This guy's crying now that this man has been talking about this guy.